Yeah, now you'll notice I deliberately stopped that video so that it stayed in one simple idea and was relatively short. Most of my students say they prefer that. The videos are shorter to upload and they can find the individual parts that they want as they move through the videos. So now imagine yourself as one of my students. What would you like about this learning method and what might go wrong? So stop the video for just a minute and give that some thought. Here's what the students say they like. These are quotes from my students. They say the video lectures are easy to watch. They're appealing. You can repeat what you miss. You can go at your own speed. You can do them on my own schedule. It makes the book easier to understand. And very interestingly, several of the students say that the way they watch the videos on their iPads especially, they make them feel like I am right at their shoulder, talking to them and showing them how to do the material. In class, they say this gives you a better understanding. We're able to answer questions. It helps me understand the homework. They like the real stuff, and I don't feel stupid asking questions. For my special needs students, the hearing impaired students, YouTube videos are automatically closed captioned. That's been very useful for one hearing impaired student that I had in class. ESL students can speed up or slow down the videos, and many of them use the closed captioning also. And then I'm wondering what the impact of this might be on gender. Maybe in my classroom you notice that I have very few women students. I'm wondering what the impact may be long term of having a woman professor in engineering being the one recording these videos. Here's what has happened with my course evaluations. In 2007, I was teaching in the traditional way. Out of a point of six, we're graded on a scale of 1 to 6. I was receiving marks of like 4.98. Overall, this was an effective course, and 5.13 for overall, this is an effective instructor. These are good scores. These are scores that would say, I'm a very good professor. And then I went on sabbatical in 2008. Said, you know, I just want to do something better and different with my teaching. I want to make my teaching more personal to my students. And when I came back, the back third of the class, the last third of this class, was done with the flipped method. Look at what happened to my teaching evaluations. They leaped. In 2010, I had virtually all of the class up online. And again, very strong teaching evaluations. In 2011, I've got a little sag in the numbers. This is an interesting problem, probably at our university, because we changed the way the course evaluations were done online, and many students said that they were confused by which course they were evaluating, or if they were evaluating the instructor or a TA. So I'm going to have to put a question mark next to these numbers, and I'll keep you posted. Now, what can go wrong? The video lectures. About 80 to 85% of the students watch the videos before class, but what about the rest? If they haven't watched the videos, the students say, class is really confusing if you haven't watched the videos. Remember, these students literally haven't seen the material and you're dropping them right into the homework. If I get a question from a student that makes it pretty clear they probably didn't watch the video, rather than answering that in front of the whole class and making the whole class sit there and wait, I'm likely to say, did you watch the video? And if they say yes, I'll answer that question. If they say no, I'm likely to say, oh, the video will probably answer that. Why didn't you go ahead and review it tonight? Now, there are some problems potentially with the format of the videos. I put mine up on YouTube, and that means that everyone can watch them as long as they have YouTube access. For example, if they are working at some of our local engineering companies, things like YouTube are blocked, so they can't watch them during their breaks. Accessibility, the ability for students to be able to find these 24/7, to be able to watch them if they are hearing impaired and so on, these are very important things as well. And then what kind of content should I put up? In class is a balancing act between discussion, applications, intuitive understanding, and homework setup. When I review my class and I ask students for comments, I always get some who say, do more homework in class, and I get an almost equal number who say, do less homework in class and more discussion of the applications. So this is an important balancing act, and it probably depends on each professor and each class. Now, what else can go wrong? From a professor's point of view, honestly, most of my videos were recorded late at night, sitting on my couch with my headset and my tablet PC. This is a balancing act for professors. I don't think it's realistic to record all of the lectures for an individual class at the same time you are teaching that class. You can do this for a portion of the class and then do it each year so that you get the entire class finished after 2 or 3 years, or you need to have some special allocated time in the summer or prior to that class. Here's a professor's nightmare, the empty classroom. What if I do such a good job that the students all understand the material and then they don't come to class and I walk in and it's an empty classroom? The day that happens, I'm probably going to rejoice because I'm going to know that I was able to explain this complicated material so well that the students didn't need any extra time. One of the experiences that the students write about is they say they watch the lecture, they think, oh, if it's easy, I don't need to go to class. And in fact, when the lectures are easy, I notice distinctly fewer students in class. But they say, when they watch the lecture and they can see that it's difficult, they make sure they come to class so that they're able to get their questions answered and get started on the homework so that they don't have to work so hard individually by themselves. So for me, the empty classroom would be a reason to rejoice, but it hasn't happened yet. Now let's talk about you. Insanely flipping your classroom and what this is going to take. Think about and write down all of the tasks that you anticipate you would need to do in order to set up your classroom in this flipped approach.